I'm honored for all of us to have as our keynote speaker today, MayKao Hong. She is president and CEO of Wilder Foundation. MayKao has extensive experience in the public and private sectors, serving low-income and disadvantaged populations. She is committed to achieving an equitable society where everyone can prosper. Having overcome adversity in her own childhood and young adult life, MayKao believes in the power of changing one life at a time and strengthening the social and civic infrastructures of our communities to transform the world. She holds academic degrees from Brown University, Hubert H. Humphrey School of Public Affairs, and Hamline University. As described in your program, MayKao's leadership has earned her prestigious recognition and awards. She extends her leadership and service throughout the Twin Cities. I heard and met MayKao yesterday at Freck and Wilder's first Overcoming Racism Leadership Workshop. MayKao revealed a glimpse of her academic passion for transforming institutions, awareness of getting in her own way as a leader, and unique ability to see and express the importance of diversity in our moving forward together. Please join me in recognizing and welcoming MayKao Hong.
Thank you for honoring me with the opportunity to deliver this speech this morning, especially among so many distinguished guests, as well as those who've worked tirelessly in this community to promote organizations and leaders who want to be diverse, inclusive, and to overcome racism. Thank you for your service, your courage, and your willingness to work as a society that values all of its members without regard to background, so that all of us can actually lead productive, full, and healthy lives. This conference is really important because it affirms and inspires all of us to continue to generate the momentum to dismantle racism. I want to thank all the Freck members, organizations, the volunteers, and I'd really like my staff at the Wilder Foundation to stand if you're here. Thank you. There's a special thank you that goes to my staff or our staff at Wilder because the truth is everything that I'm going to be talking about today about how Wilder has transformed belongs to the leadership at all levels at the foundation. And I know I couldn't do this without all of you. So nothing this special happens at an organization without leadership from you. And nothing special like this conference happens without leadership from Freck and so many community partners. So I feel really blessed to live in a community that can come together like this. So I'm gonna talk for about 40 minutes and I'm gonna leave some time for questions in case anybody has any of that. And I did not bring a PowerPoint with me today, big shocker, because I feel like we need to be more disciplined with listening to each other from the heart. Like you, I want to live in a society that's free of racism. Dismantling our legacy of racism is still one of the biggest challenges that we face as a society. I'd like to experience a day when we no longer need an Overcoming Racism conference, actually, but that is not this day. The other reason why I'm here is to remind you that our work is not finished. Our work is not finished when most indicators of health, education, community well-being, and racial disparities of all types are so large and persistent. Our work is not finished when allies for and champions for equity, like Sue Hagg of the Met Council, are not supported in our community. Our work is not finished when we have so many college students and graduates of color without jobs, even though they're highly qualified, when we keep talking about employment disparities. And though it is bittersweet when I listen to leaders that work with me talk about a deficit mentality, with a deficit mentality, about people of color, and I'm in the room, I know that our work is not finished. It's not like all of us who are people of color are criminals, low income, or lack the aspirations to pull ourselves up. And yet, I am there, and they forget. And finally, our work is not finished when we're still afraid, as parents of color, that Michael Brown will be our child. Because that's what I'm afraid of. I have a really tall, 5'10" son who lives in Woodbury. And our work's really not finished when my daughter, who's 14, comes home from Woodbury and says, "Mom, people constantly ask me, where are you from? What kind of Asian are you?" And I said, "Well, you know, what do you say, honey?" And she says, "Well, I asked them, what kind of white are you?" It's a small win, I know, but she's my daughter. And I was quite proud of her response, because recovery is really important. So I'm so happy that there is a Wilder can join the chorus of organizations and people in this community who are a growing force to really dismantle racism and address it in our society. So I'm going to talk about three things today, major groupings. The first is just an image that I hold dear when it gets really challenging for me. Because, you know, unlike what most people assume a CEO does, just because you're in the top position doesn't mean that it's any easier for you. It just gets harder. Second, I'd like to share some insights that I've gained from working on my doctoral studies at Hamline University around race and representation, especially in local county human services. And what white people think and how they work, because, you know, that's highly curious to me as a person of color. I have no idea. And then I want to actually tell you about some of the work that we're doing at the Wilder Foundation, some lessons that we've learned. And I'd like to close, actually, today, this morning, by issuing a challenge to all of you so that you can go back with concrete actions that you could take to look into your hearts and minds and organizations to cultivate transformation. So before I do this, because I am the president of the Wilder Foundation, because so much of this is about some of our own experimental work and trying solutions, I'd like to tell you about the Wilder Foundation, because it gives you a context for why I'm in the role that I'm in, and why this conference, and why our work. So Wilder is a nonprofit organization that's dedicated to improving the human condition. It was founded in 1906, and it committed us to existing into perpetuity to serve all people, to improve lives, regardless of background. In fact, it has one of the earliest anti-discrimination statements and clauses on record in the state of Minnesota, and perhaps nationally. For over a century, we've existed to serve those who are in need, those who are low income, and those who are sick. We're an organization that provides services across the lifespan, and we also work to build the capacity of the community to do the same thing. We have applied social research and evaluation, and we are kind of the smart human services people, so we're experimenting with solutions in the real world and in the community. For example, and I know Leah Driscoll, who's on staff, is here, we're working right now to launch a mobile grocery store that will eliminate transportation barriers right into low-income neighborhoods to address some of these social determinants of health. Every 2.5 miles in the city of St. Paul, there's a Wilder staff person or volunteer that's delivering a critical human service. And last year, about 18% of what is the equivalent to the population of St. Paul, or 55,000 people, convened at our space at Wilder Center to work on mission-related activities to improve our community. That's Wilder Foundation. We've changed for 100 years, and we're changing again. So that's the context. Now first, the image that I hold really dear when things get hard for me as a leader, because I know that you've all been there. If you really care about this work, you've been challenged. And the challenges often come in forms that you can't even anticipate, right? So when I first got married, my husband Lou and I lived in a really rough neighborhood on the east side of St. Paul. Lou and I are both Hmong, and we were settled as refugees, first-generation college students. We'd overcome a lot of barriers. I grew up in St. Paul. He grew up in a town of 200 people, German Lutherans, in Michigan. Coming out of poverty, being homeless, displaced, learning a new language on top of that was really challenging for both of us. So here's the example of the rough neighborhood we lived in. One day, when my husband left his car in the alley, he came out of the apartment to find that poop and urine had been tossed over his Honda Accord. It was normal to find broken windows in our neighborhood because there were so many rocks thrown at our windows. This was a neighborhood that was mostly in transition, becoming low-income white to black to Hmong. We don't even know who hated us. It seemed that even the children in the streets called us names. Like, I'd be outside and someone would ride a bike and someone would throw out a racial slur. And one night, my husband rushed to aid a neighbor who had been stabbed in the stomach. He was stopping the flow of blood with his hands. His wife had stabbed him because of a domestic situation. He had been choking her. And at the time, I was actually giving my son Fuchi, who was 6 months old, a bath. The struggle seemed endless and unsurmountable to me, even having lived the life that I had lived. And then one day, when I was doing dishes in relative peace, I looked out of the kitchen window and saw something that almost made my heart stop. And the tears started streaming down my face. Can anyone guess what it was? Well, I'll tell you. In the alley behind our apartment building, I saw the backs of two little girls with their skirts fluttering in the wind. One was black and the other was Asian. I think the Asian girl was Hmong. And they were both about 7 years old. They were holding hands and keeping each other safe, walking across the shards of broken glass down the long, narrow alley. It was obviously a dangerous path, and each was helping the other get across. Their hands reached out for each other halfway, taking turns. And in that moment, I still tear up when I think about it. In that moment, I saw a flash of the beauty that is the unconditional love and friendship that is present in humankind before we destroy it with our structural inequality and the forces of socialization that work to continuously separate ourselves from our humanity. The future was so present in these girls, this image. Almost immediately, they erased my pessimism and the growing hatred that had planted itself in my heart. I was able to become more forgiving again and to let my optimism flow back. Here's the thing I've never understood about Americans. We're a country built with displaced people. We have legacies we've inherited from previous generations. 350 years of violence, terror, and horror, which we have to overcome today. We want transformation, but forget that it was only 50 years ago that women and people of color and those who are disadvantaged gained the full rights of citizenship. And that previous to this, those who were in these categories, if we asserted ourselves, were subjected to violence, death, torture, ignorance, and so many other things. Climbing outside of our social boundaries was reinforced with terror and destitution and so many things until the civil rights movement. So advancing social justice and equity is like that. It can be beautiful but hard. It can also be dangerous. And holding hands across races, classes, genders is absolutely necessary. Too often, we don't reach out our hands enough as people of color or as white people, as females to males, as people with disabilities, and those who are perfectly healthy and fine. I'm here to tell you, we're all a part of this racial equation, regardless of race, because that's what we're talking today about. If we remember that the bond of love that is in humankind can overcome fear, courage will come. We have to have the emotional and social and professional courage to do what is right. Overcoming racism is more about overcoming and moving beyond our personal comfortable space. There's nothing mystical or magical about the institutions that we have and that we hold dear. We created them, we can uncreate them. I know that the many valiant efforts of all of you have actually paved a way to this conference. And I really want to thank you for being part of the courageous leadership that continues to press forward. We must claim our humanity and reject complacency. So hold on to your own dear image to actually make sure that you are being as brave and courageous as you can possibly be. We don't sweep that alley enough. With knowledge, access, and opportunity, those of us who are the privileged few because you must be privileged if you can sit here. Outside of this event lies reality. Let's get to work. Why? Because racism is not episodic. It has the power to socialize all of us inside and outside of the institutions of which we are a part. Unless trust is tightened across races, cultivating organizational change can't occur. And we have to do this one relationship at a time, extend a hand, generate trust, and create solutions together. Unlike those little girls, we have not been as generous as we possibly could be, extending a hand and reaching out to the middle to lift each other up. So if you're working for me at the Wilder Foundation, you're gonna extend your hand. Doesn't matter if you're black, you're white, you're Asian, you're Native American, I don't care. If you're signing up for our mission, you're signing up to do hard work. You're signing up to love each other and to protect each other, to be loyal to each other, and to have really hard conversations. So we've been disrupting our peace all over the place at the Wilder Foundation, taking on emotional, personal, and professional risk, running towards transformation, sometimes running away, you know, because we've had staff do that too. But then, you know, maybe it's not time for them. So I had a flash of insight when I was working at Ramsey County Human Services as a division director. I used to run all the county-based social services for people who are 18 and over in the county. And I worked there 10 years ago when the anti-racism initiative was just forming. And boy, that was hard. And I was actually the only director of color, so I kept an anti-racism log to keep myself, like, reflective. And I had this amazing boss, Monty Martin, who was the director of human services, who really was committed to this racial equity thing, except he called it changing demographics. He couldn't figure out he really wanted to work on anti-racism. Took about 2 years for us to get there. I mean, this is like how it goes. You know, and in a flash of insight, as the only person who was a director of color there, I realized, because I extended my hand for the first time to a white guy, heterosexual white male, married, 2 children, the insight I gained was that, wow, if socializing me as a person of color was as strong as racism socializing him as a white person, it must be so strong that he can't really see it. Can't see it without me reflecting it back to him, because I think about race all the time. You know, it's like I think about it all the time. It's not that I want to. It's because it disrupts my life, okay? So I don't go around saying, hey, MayKao, Asian person, Hmong, you know, ethnic, whatever. And then something says something. Some people, you know, they just forget and they do stuff and then it makes me remember. So I started getting really curious about white people, right? And here I am and I decided, I changed jobs, I went to Wilder. And I thought, you know, I'll just do this doctorate in public administration at Hamline University so I can figure out what the heck's going on. I was really curious, you know, why are we always studying racism from the perspective of people of color? I mean, aren't there more white people in the world who are in leadership positions? So after a couple of years of wandering around on my proposals, those of you who have PhDs, you know what I'm talking about. The research question is so hard to come up with, at least it was for me. And I was trying to do this, working full-time at Wilder as a new CEO, 4 kids, and going to graduate school. But I finally landed on a great topic, which I was highly curious about. So I focused my dissertation on white people in government who are actually working to represent racial minorities. Like, how are they actually doing it? You know, what are the personal and organizational factors that contribute to that? Because I knew what was contributing to myself to kind of move things along, but I had no idea, why are these white people doing this? You know, we assume it's true that, you know, if you're black, you're representing maybe people who are black and you have that, you know, view of the world, but, you know, what does it really say? What does the research really say? Well, you know, the research says that that is actually, in fact, true for those of you who are curious about that, but no studies of any kind on white people in government. Mine was the first of its kind. Can you believe that? Yeah. I had to draw from the fields of sociology, psychology, political science, you know, to study public administration, which is a huge, huge, powerful force in our society, right? So why study race and representation in the perspective of white people? I'm moving into the second segment here, which is really about my studies. So in public service, we have this ethic, and, you know, if you're working in the nonprofit sector, you know, you have this ethic as well. There's really an ethic of service in public administration that says, we are here to represent all and serve all people, and to make sure that all are included. This ethic of race to achieve social equity is really, really challenging, right? Because of our centuries of oppression, slavery, colonialism, war, and white racial framing. Racial disparities persist across sector, and public efforts are underway, but oftentimes it's those public institutions that need to change. They need to inform themselves, and we keep trying to say, well, can you please, people of color out here, kind of inform us? And it's like, no, you're the ones that need to change, all right? The study was really unique because it was really looking at white allies, people of color over the centuries have not been alone in making the progress that's been made. Partly it's been because we've had very little power in an authoritative sense to actually make changes. So what do we know from the research about being white? We all know that race is socially constructed, there's no biological basis, and that race forms in relation to others, reinforced because we socialize inside of our racial group, and then we get kicked out of other racial groups, right? We're assigned a social value. And actually, when you get out too far, then people actually push you back in again. So if you get too successful as a person of color, or you get too oriented towards understanding as a white person, the experience of people of color, your own group actually tosses you out. That's a really hard thing. So it can work against you. Your own group can work against you because they also define those boundaries. And because society, because of how we have socialized people, actually assigns value to a person, and it follows them throughout society, in jobs, in community organizing, in academia, we have wealth inequality, right? Being white is also being about the norm. The norm was created by white people who are in power. Nothing against white people today. Use your privilege as a tool and a weapon for good, those of you who are white. It's just there. We can't even identify it anymore. Now, what are the characteristics of whiteness? This was interesting. Social dynamics that create structural advantages without us needing to think about it. A lot of white people who are anti-racist allies actually reject their whiteness because they feel like they did nothing to earn it. And I hate to tell you guys this, white people, but I know you didn't do anything. That's what racism is. Okay, like I reject my Asian-ness too. Like I actually think of myself as Hmong, all right? But society kind of tells me I'm Asian and they treat me that way and there's nothing I can do about it. So it's all very frustrating for all of us in society. But I want you to know that I finally get it after these studies that white people also don't like it, and it's okay, you don't have to. Being white, the characteristics of whiteness is that you are unmarked and invisible, which means there's color blindness, arguments around color blindness, it's totally not conscious, and a lot of times people who are white say, well, I don't have a culture. Yeah, you do. Everybody has a culture. Understanding it, making it visible is actually the first step to gaining consciousness. Whiteness also resists challenges. So actually whiteness asserts itself when it is the most challenged. And by the way, that's true for people of color too. But I was studying white people, so I'm talking about white people. The myth of meritocracy, it reinforces white superiority, manifest destiny given to us by God, individual action got me here, all these different things. When in fact there were a lot of federal, local, and state policies that actually, and private actions that reinforce those things. And white identity can be positive or negative. In other words, you can be a white person who has a strong white identity who's an anti-racist ally, and you can be a white person who has a really strong identity to be fascist and to believe that you are the most superior race. Kind of scary, actually, when I found that out. One of the things in looking through the research was that actually the more educated a white person is, the less likely they are to actually think about race or to actually think about racial equity at all. So you'd think that would be the opposite, right? That the most educated of us who are white would actually be because of our big brains and our ability to gain consciousness, that we would actually do better. But it turns out that's not true. Low-income whites and middle-class whites are actually a lot more racially conscious and care about it than upper-income whites. So in anti-racism work, which is a lot of what you guys do, exposure of white people to people of color is supposed to, like, raise consciousness, right? And move towards the creation of a non-racist world. Huh, turns out that's not so true. Because exposure doesn't mean engagement, and belief doesn't mean action. That was one of the major findings from my research study. So let me give you an example of how racism impacts people through public administration, or like through just people who create rules or part of some large system. I was unable to actually take a shower at a public park a number of years ago with my children, and it was because I was Asian. When I confronted the park ranger, he told me I could actually take my babies down to the river or go like a block down to the pump, because I was not a registered camper. Even though I was actually registered, what he meant was I hadn't paid for a site that had public shower capacity. But as any white person, you could have paid to go into the park and showered and nobody would have noticed. Well, you know, there were a lot of us because I was with my sisters and we couldn't go in. So here you have, you know, a somewhat neutral policy that was inconsistently applied. It was inconsistently applied because I was an Asian person, and obviously I was marked in some way. So we have public administrators and staff people all over the state of Minnesota who are doing this. I'm applying policy, but it's being inconsistently reinforced because I see that you're different. I never was able to wring an apology out of the park ranger who was there. So it's really, really important that we raise consciousness and at all levels of an organization, because when you're part of an institution that is public, you are what I call the sovereign. What does the sovereign mean? The sovereign means you have absolute authority and regulatory power to create and frame changes in a way that must be complied with. The authority to enforce is present, and that's true of any public organization, right? So that's a pretty awesome amount of power. Active representation, which is what I'm talking about, where you say, you know what, I know that there are no black people here, but let me think about what it might be to be a black person here getting this service or going into the camp, means that you're actually adopting a role to represent those racial interests that is quite different from your own personal journey. That's hard to do because, like Monty and I, Monty Martin at the Department of Human Services and I, we've lived such different lives. You know, how do you even step over that chasm to understand that? So I interviewed for this dissertation process 15 people, white public administrators, all levels of leadership and authority in a rural county, urban county, suburban county, and a rural county. What were the results? What are these? What did I learn? So I'm just going to go through this really quickly. I found that whites who are actually taking action, who are the most racially conscious and intentional about their actions, deliberately use their privilege as a tool for good. In other words, they were unapologetic. So I talked to an administrator pretty high level up in a suburban county who said, oh yeah, when the Trayvon Martin thing happened, I did covert organizing and I actually played the President Obama tape and invited all my staff to come and view it so we could talk about disparities in the child protection system. She used an event in society to actually leverage her leadership to make change. And I said, well, did you tell them that that's what you were doing? She goes, oh no, why would I do that? But she didn't apologize for it. Yep, covert action, totally did it, was fine. They were also people who kind of weren't afraid to socialize outside of work with people of color. They had relationship circles that expanded far beyond their own race. That was pretty interesting. But they were unapologetic. You know, the other thing that was counter to what most people think as I need support all the way up and down the chain of command was that, by and large, I found this social worker in rural Minnesota who was making massive change at the county with Latino and Somali residents that were growing in number. So these were only counties that had experienced more than a 10% demographic change. She actually was transforming the entire county. And the only thing she really needed was the support of her direct supervisor. It turns out that the support of your direct supervisor to give you discretion to actually make changes is kind of enough, because you don't have to do so much permission seeking all the time. And because she was someone who was really racially and culturally conscious, she was able to be the catalyst that was transforming her organization. Very counter to what some people think. Well, you know, don't you have to go higher up in leadership? Nope, turns out no. You know, the other thing that was really interesting, and by the way, you can get the whole 227-page dissertation if you'd like to read ad nauseum about this. I'm only sharing three things with you that I thought was really interesting, is that every single person I talked to and interviewed believed in an anti-racist world. They understood that they had a white racial identity, they had privilege. But privilege did not mean, and understanding did not mean, that they could actually identify actions to advance racial equity. They couldn't do it. More than half of them in the interview, so the interviews were only an hour, from the beginning of stating this is my belief system to the end where I had them give examples about how they were advancing racial equity, there was bias. There was bias in terms of the identification of whiteness being invisible, believing that they were superior, all these different things. Wow, these were people who were trying to work on this. So one of the really interesting things that I found is that, you know what, just because you believe and you are working on it, so like I interviewed someone really high up in county government, working on employment disparities all the time. Guess what he was doing? Perpetuating racial disparities. Because the solutions that were present were ill-fitting and the problem definition was wrong because they were from a white racial frame. So, you know, and there was a group that was very conflicted. So the most conflicted group, the group of white people that I feel like we can really work with, were the ones that truly believed and they were trying, but there was no one to support them through this learning process. So they were half conscious, half racially conscious. In other words, they were working pretty hard, but they didn't know what to do. How many of you have said, you know, I really care about dismantling racism, but I have no idea what to do? Raise your hand. Right, okay. Well, this is going to become very concrete for you then, this next part that I'm working on at Wilder. So, you know, when you're partially racially conscious, but you don't have the courage to leap over to action and to enlist support for your own learning, you have unresolved personnel issues. They look like they're racial issues. They look like they're performance issues. I have no idea what that is. You know, I'm sure some of you have struggled with this. There's an inability to actually make transformational initiatives around race and disparities go. And there's inconsistent efforts because you're just really tired. You know, you don't know how to make it work, okay? So we have to help this group that is partially conscious go from belief, partial consciousness, to actually action. We need to support our anti-racist white allies to actually do better. And, you know, I've got a whole bunch of recommendations, which I'm not going to talk about here. But I just want you to know that it's really important, because we can't do it just as people of color. So, you know, this brings me to kind of the concrete actions that we've taken at the foundation. And I'm going to go through these, just to give you some lessons, okay? You know, one of the things that we've learned at Wilder, not only rushing towards conflict and to use it as a tool for transformation and getting people to say, you know what, we need to be in relationships with each other. The bond of us as people who work together from different races has to be stronger than the challenges that come to actually disrupt us as human beings. That's a lot for me to ask my staff, but it is the only thing that will help us transform. Okay, so do you guys have iPhones or like phones that can take pictures? Okay, so if you have one, take it out. Okay, now turn it to the function, the camera function that kind of swings around so you can do a selfie. Okay, now take a picture of yourself. Okay. Okay, I see Sue doing a backwards selfie. Oh, okay. All right. Well, okay, now I want you to look at your iPhones. Who's in there? Who's there? You, maybe some people behind you. Okay. How many, okay, this is actually not a trick question. Okay, how many people got a picture of themselves? Raise your hand. Yes, okay, good job. How many of you work for institutions? Raise your hand. All right, good job. All right, okay, you've all passed. That was the major lesson for today. The message I'm taking out and what we've learned from the Wilder Foundation and the work there is we're part of the problem. We all work in institutions, and if we don't provide the leadership to do self-directed learning and create ownership over the problem, we may be perpetuating disparities, not eliminating them. And we can't rely on other people to actually direct our learning. We've got to want to do it. So as institutional leaders who sit at different positions in the organization, you're the one that needs to change. You're the one. And if we can accept that as a lesson around cultivating transformation, that we are a part of the problem, then we can also be a part of the solution. But if we reject that we are part of the problem, then the solution lies elsewhere, and we can feel guilty but not be action-oriented. Because guilt is very self-serving, right? I talk to a lot of people who feel guilty. I don't want anyone to feel guilty. I want them to be mad. I want them to actually do stuff. That's one of the lessons. So keep your selfie. You can put a note to it, post it. I'm the problem. I'm going to change, okay? Nope, it's true. The other thing is that, you know, one of the things that we've learned is there has to be a role for everyone. You know, we're very good at, like, excluding people from being part of the solution. And at the Wilder Foundation, what we've done is we've developed a very simple framework for giving roles to every single staff person and every single formal and informal group. So the board has a role. What is our board's role? Steward the mission. Remember to remind us about the anti-discrimination and diversity clause. And you do the work too, because you're the key leaders in this organization. What's the CEO role? Champion and ambassador. Create transparency inside and outside the organization. Measure progress. Don't run away from conflict. Enlist the support of informal and formal leaders. You know, so I was heartened during the research process to know, because one of the things we do at Wilder, which, I mean, other institutional leaders I talk to are like, what? You do what? Say, oh, no, we have our staff of color or people who are a lot more culturally competent mentoring our senior leaders, and sometimes they're like line staff. They're not people who have any, like, formal authority. You know, that's kind of scary because, you know, it could go down really bad, you know? It really could. So we actually have qualified IDI administrators on staff because, and they help each other, okay? But we don't really have enough people, and we're too cheap because we're a nonprofit, right? We got to be thrifty. So we have qualified administrators, $20 for every IDI interpretation. And employees who have no authority at all, it seems like, in the organization are given a role too. What's their role? Self-directed learning, create ownership. So we have a benchmark in the foundation to actually move our entire workforce an entire stage ahead using the intercultural development inventory, which is a cultural competency tool. And we now know that 48% of our staff are in acceptance or adaptation. That's really amazing to me. And we're about a 400-person organization. So, you know, that's another lesson. Give everybody a role. Make everybody feel included. You know, frankly, if you're an Asian person at Wilder and you come to me and you say, well, you know, I'm really culturally competent, whatever, and I say, okay, what about working with Black kids? Are you okay with that? You know, there's a journey that never ends here with learning about other cultures and people. The other thing is, and how many of you are actually stuck in the definition process? Like, you say racial equity, and there are like 10 interpretations. Raise your hand. Or you say diversity, and there's like 10 interpretations. Okay. Well, that's kind of where Wilder was, like about 7 years ago when I started there. And we introduced a framework so that we could use the same language. It's not perfect because it's just a tool for change, but we now use the same language. This is a resistance strategy from institutions. if you can just keep defining and redefining what all of this actually means, then you really don't have to do anything, right? How many of you are working in an organization that might perhaps be stuck in this little stage? Yeah, right. Go back and commit to language that can be used across your organizations. It's amazing how helpful that is. The other thing that I have done, or we have done at Wilder, is that we don't mandate anything. We don't make anybody do anything. We set broad metrics, and we say, we want to work towards this kind of vision and world. Will you be a part of the solution? Here's a role for you. You are welcome to create conflict if you want to. And we will help us ourselves through this process. So our efforts are voluntary and organic. Now, I was at the leadership workshop yesterday, and there was a comment made about there are all these different racial equity things. I mean, like the commissioner of MDH is doing stuff, and Wilder's got some racial equity network, and Itasca with CIOs is doing, CEOs are doing something. And you know, it's just like, why can't we get aligned? And I think we have to shift our approach. The voluntary organic nature of eliminating racism is go with where the energy is. Fuel the momentum, don't stop it. Because, you know, another resistance strategy that organizations use is, well, there's not alignment, so I guess I can't do anything. There's not alignment. There is always alignment. There's alignment between 2 people, 5 people, 10 people, 20 people, 30 people, supervisors, executive teams. Make it voluntary and organic. Because if you aren't doing that, then you're stopping the forces of change. We can link up later after the movement's been created. I don't think, like, during the Civil Rights Movement, people said to Dr. King, you know, we're just not aligned. I mean, are you kidding me? We have to unleash the energy of this community. Why do we keep talking about that? Okay, so the other thing that's created change and cultivating transformation is, you know, we have to create pressure as organizational leaders from inside and outside the institution. So I subject myself to humility around mistakes that we have to learn as an institution. I put myself out there as the first authentic leader to say, my gosh, we messed up. I was not racially conscious enough. I was not good enough. And I am eating humble pie because I couldn't do it the way that it was supposed to be done. So inside of our organization, we have resource networks that keep management good. And we tell them, don't celebrate diversity. Go to action. You know, most of these affinity groups are, you know, we want you to, like, support each other, but please don't do anything to disrupt management. You know, and by the way, we're not even going to give you resources. Well, forget that. Give them resources. Make them do stuff. Help them. Help you create strategic advantages for change in your institutions. And don't be afraid. The conflict that happens is the good stuff. We also do things like, you know, we have a performance factor that is around diversity that helps. We report our results out to the community. I'm doing it to you right now. And then we try to respond to calls for assistance and help, which is, you know, in the future, hopefully a diversity institute where we can bring organizational leaders in who want to do the same kind of work that we're doing to help teach and learn and educate and have mutual accountability setting. So we talked about conflict, that's a big one. You know, the thing that I'd say about this is you cannot expect people of color or white people or any people in your institutions to be able to do this alone. You can't do it alone even as the CEO. You need a safe space where there's complete confidentiality that will never be violated when you talk about trying out solutions and reserving judgment and learning how to say the words out loud about what you're experiencing and what you're doing is really, really important because we lack the language to identify what we are experiencing. And it's because if I'm wearing Commissioner Ellinger's glasses and I can't see the way he sees, you know, we have to come together. But it's not enough. You know, the other thing we've done, because by and large, we don't know which policies are creating racial disparities at Wilder. We have to become racially and culturally competent enough with skills, racially conscious in terms of how is racism surfacing, to actually do a root cause analysis on the policies and practices that are perpetuating disparities in the community. And we can only do that if we have enough validation from people who understand. So here's an insight that we gained from our HR director. The insight we gained was because of Wilder's compensation over time, because women and people of color have had so much less time to gain an education, all these other things, by and large, our seniority-based compensation system favored white men. So compensation was inequitably distributed, and we're in the process of reworking that right now. I didn't have to tell our HR director to do that. She's an HR specialist. She had to identify that, because there's no way that all of us can identify all of these different things. Likewise, in the GLBT community and how different forms are, you know, put out, we had to have the GLBT ERG tell us that there was bias being created towards heterosexism. People, heterosexual world that was making clients that we were serving uncomfortable. So it's not just enough to, the identification process and the solutions can't be seen if people aren't racially conscious or culturally competent enough to actually say something about it, because we lack the language. And then, you know, finally, one of the lessons that we've learned is that we can always assume, and we never question, that people of color are right about their life experience. It's amazing the dismissals that happen throughout an institution when we start listening to people of color, incorporating their views into a design process, how often they are told that they're wrong. They are told that they're wrong. You must just not get this piece or that piece. And it's like, you know what? Why don't we just say, you're always right? I like it when people tell me that. People of color have to control their own narratives. Okay? So, you know, I guess I'm starting to wrap up now, but there's no progress without discomfort or challenge. In other words, conflict is part of the change equation to transform our belief systems and, in fact, move to action. Too often, we don't have the reciprocity and trust across different races in order to do this, and we let the tension go on too long. If we are lucky enough as white people, as people of color, as people who sit in different corners, to have someone hold the mirror up to us to express our reality like the selfie, we are a lucky few, because most people just walk off the job. Your highly talented staff are walking off. Your community providers aren't wanting to work with you. So let me just say that I continue to see when people suffer because other people are not willing to move across their comfort zones. Here's when I see it. I see it when an educated and successful person of color refuses to take a risk to speak out because they're afraid something will happen to them, that there'll be negative consequences. I see it when I see discomfort or people staying in their comfort zones from the dominant white culture when they wait for the minority person of color to speak, even though they're the ones that need to speak up on their behalf. I see it when a person turns away from someone who sits in a wheelchair because it makes them uncomfortable. And I see it when people choose in their free time to only socialize with people who look exactly like them. We have to disrupt our personal peace for progress to advance racial equity. And that means taking risks to advocate for ourselves and to be allies for others, taking turns in the alley. If you're a person of color working to identify, to eliminate your own internalized oppression, the trauma that you've experienced so that you can heal and move on, and as a white person using your privilege and turning it into a weapon to defeat bigotry, hatred, and injustice. Work on seeing your own race and practice every day how you can do it better. And I want you to know that the status quo is always easier to maintain because it's easier. But maintaining the status quo means transformation won't occur. So we need to practice, and just like a good entrepreneur, you have to risk more often to be more successful more often. And we're probably not risking enough, even me. We can also be hard on those who aren't moving fast enough. And we all have to be more generous, forgive ourselves and each other to work and press forward. We have to build each other's confidence because intent does not equal effective impact. We offend, we have unconscious bias towards others, and despite our best attempts, sometimes we're our own worst enemies. And if we care and come back, we need to learn how to try something else. But nobody is responsible for your learning. You are responsible for it, to dismantle racism inside of yourself. So what do we do? How do we plant and create new ways of being together? Well, in this community, I believe we have all the right ingredients to change to overcome racism. But I believe we are having trouble creating the recipes. We keep wondering if some new network or group is going to come up with the recipe for us. Well, I'm telling you that one recipe just isn't enough. It's many recipes. And to debunk this myth that we somehow can't overcome racism, I want you to know that I've seen it happen and we can do it. So here's a concrete challenge to you. I've learned over the years in being in public administration and at Wilder and other places that budgeting is a values exercise. Some people think it's actually about numbers. It's not about numbers. It's a values exercise. So what I want you to do this year is I want to have you be advocates to allocate and reallocate resources to fuel this work in terms of time, money, and people to generate the impact that we want to see in the world to dismantle and eliminate racism. So go and examine your good intentions and your belief systems and see if there's measurable financial impact within your own organizations and from your own pocketbook to organizations and causes that are working to eliminate racism. Because budgeting is a values exercise, what we do financially and with our staff reflects what we think is most important. Do some analysis on what you're spending and pay attention to whether your efforts are really standing behind your belief systems and your values. Everywhere you touch with resources as institutional leaders, work to advance the kind of world that you want to see. So I'm very blessed to be in a role that gives me the platform to talk about Wilder's work and in a role where I can actually assist other organizations to improve. And I want to thank you so much for listening to my very long speech this morning. I have a few minutes to take questions, I believe, right? Yeah, okay. Does anybody have questions or comments? Over here, Naida.
Greetings.
Yeah?
I'm really...
Yep, we're good.
I'm really excited to have heard you speak like this. I know we've worked together. You've come down to our office, and I appreciate you taking the time at Aurora St. Anthony to hear about the work that we are doing. Came about because of the St. Paul Promise neighborhood work, but I have been charged up to know that this is going on at Wilder. I'm very, very, very excited to hear this and to hear your framework. Was extremely exciting from a different perspective about white folk. Thank you.
Thanks, MayKao. Hosey Thurman worked with Wilder some time ago, and glad to hear that the work they're doing now. My question, the 5 years that I worked there as an African-American male was a very lonely time there in the organization. So my question is, what is the organization doing now to reach out to the African-American community in St. Paul and recruiting of through HR of qualified African Americans within the organization?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, one of the things that we're trying to do is build leaders within the organization and to give institutional supports in a way that doesn't leave people out alone. So recruiting is helpful. I mean, we've moved in the last few years to being 40% people of color in the organization. Numbers help. You know, so we have about 18% turnover, and over the period of, I think, 5 or 6 years, we have increased the ratio of the share of our staff of color by 7%, which means that we had to retain and we had to hire new people. Now, I'd have to go back and see what it looks like in terms of the figures moving up, but our promotions of people of color have increased about 1% a year. So we're not that big, but we're trying really hard, and I think we still have a long ways to go with promoting inclusion, making people feel welcome once they do come, both as an institution and also as people across races. But I think that we're doing a better job than probably when you were there. And we will never do the perfect job. It will never be perfect because there's a mutual relationship that occurs. And really what I'm looking for from new staff of color and white staff is, are you wanting to sign up for this? Do you want to engage in creating and making the organization better? So we have an employee engagement measure that's really around taking leadership around diversity and inclusion efforts. And we have a benchmark of 30% of our staff, all staff at Wilder, engaging in some leadership capacity. We're at 39% now. So 39% of our workforce is engaged in some way in some leadership activity, and that's participating in an ERG, being part of our inclusion action team, which runs our diversity efforts, you know, being a manager that has committed to action, to moving people along in their journey to be more culturally competent or racially aware. So things like that. So we're doing better. Yeah, but we're not perfect, and I don't think we ever will be. Yeah. Other questions?
Can I take one more question? All right, I'm on my way.
There's one down here, too.
This one down here? Okay, yeah. I'll take you, and then I'll come up to you, all right?
Thank you for your insightful comments. But the recent increase in diversity in Minnesota has been largely been fueled by non-Eurocentric immigration with an overlay of lingual and cultural diversity. Mm-hmm. So when we look at these migratory cultural formations, they are anchored in a very strong sense of identity. Mm-hmm. Identity with which, you know, we come. And from that perspective, when it comes into close contact with other groups, there's bound to be hybridization of culture, mm-hmm. both in the majority culture as well as in the minority culture. And in that, we have two choices. Either that hybridization can occur in a harmonious fashion or in a conflict or some combination of the two. So how do we manage the composition of harmony and conflict in that situation?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, I think one of the mistakes that we make, because we do have a racial frame that's been created over a couple of centuries here, is that we lump people into one group and then we say, oh, but you're black. You know, even if you're Somali or you're Eritrean or some other thing. Happens a lot to the Asian American community because we have so many different ethnicities. But the hybridization does occur, but generationally, so like the Hmong have been in this country now for 40 years. What I'm seeing at Wilder is that the same patterns of internalized oppression and racism and the dynamics around economic inequality, if that first generation of immigrants or refugees don't make it through, they become victim to the same dynamics that our other racial communities have had forever in this country. That's how strong racism is. So, you know, one of the things that that can maybe help reconcile this is for people to understand that, and it took me a long time, quite frankly, to say, I'm Asian American, you know, because I was always ever Hmong. I mean, I speak Hmong, I grew up in that culture, is that that's not how people treat me, whether I choose to accept that or not. So they only see an Asian American woman who's at some conference or, you know, I mean, I could be anything. And the Asian American experience, and I can only speak from my own, is that you are the perpetual foreigner, and you are often forgotten from racial dialogue. Because you are the perpetual foreigner, even third generation Chinese Americans are asked, where are you from, where are you from? You're never, ever legitimately here. And so, you know, the hybridization is still occurring in a socio-political and economic context, which created a lot of structural advantages for people of one type and not of the other. What it has done, at least in our community and in the API community, is it has masked the racism that impacts so many groups that are not as highly educated coming from overseas. And so, you know, I do think that those dynamics will shake out over time, but I'm not seeing, at least from a policy perspective, any changes in that capacity. So like we are still only accepting immigrants federally that fit certain categories. You can come if you're an engineer and you're Asian American. You can come if you're a doctor. But you know, you can't come if you're from Burma, or you can't come if you're from this other place. And you know, it's still very widespread. Targets are set every year through immigration policies. And the target for a period of, I think, 60 years was only white European Americans. It was a very dark time, actually, for Asian Americans in this country, because if you were Chinese American during that time and some crime happened to you, you couldn't be counted as your own witness. You were denied the rights to actually serve as your own witness, policy-wise, through the courts. So, you know, that legacy for Chinese Americans it gets perpetuated today. And, you know, I mean, it does lead to a lot of wealth inequality. So I think that I like to be hopeful about the hybridization occurring, but I think history shows us that without intentional action to dismantle policies at that level, that we will continue to see some of the things that we see. And that's actually why we continue to experience some of the problems that we have in our society. It's not just about history, it's actually about today. We're still creating things today. And I found in my research that we were still creating things today that don't do anything for people of color or advancing racial equity, even from those who believe that they're doing it. Any other? Oh, there was a question up there. Yeah.
Stand. Yes, I got to stand. And thank you. I love your speech today. It was great. Question I have, and I've worked in for-profit, non-profit, and now I'm working for a smaller, privately owned company. And I've also worked in the area of diversity for years, so I'm familiar with what, as far as educating and forming a diversity team. But I will say this last job that I have and is, as a diversity manager is the most challenging for whatever reason. I don't know, is it just the society, where things are today, what people have endured over the past year. But for me and probably a lot of other folks, I think I'm struggling with how to really move this organization to have an appreciation for diversity, to move the organization in a direction just understanding diversity and racism. Overall, I'm the only person of color sitting in the office, which I was amazed by, because you know we're in the 20th century and now I'm the only person of color walking through the door. It was surprising to me. But nonetheless, and my role is the diversity manager, but I'm trying to figure out how to move this organization forward in a white male dominated organization that is really, they want diversity, but they don't know really what that really means. So I'm just asking you for your advice on that.
Wow, I'm so glad you asked. Because that was the exact situation I was in. Except I wasn't the diversity manager. I was the division director in adult services at Ramsey County. you know, I think what I did, and I don't know if this would help you, is I thought about it as making sure, you know, I mean, I just tried to find one other person. And I had, because I had no people of color working with me, I said, is there one person on this senior team that can actually be my ally? So, you know, frankly, like, I had lunch with them, and I talked to them, and I learned about who they were, and then I realized when I had actually enough confidence, I was quite young when I had that job. I think I just turned 30. I decided that I was going to let some of them in a little bit because of their respective backgrounds, understanding poverty. Because you know, it doesn't have to be understanding race. I mean, as long as you can anchor people. And not also see white people as all monolithic. That's the other thing that we do as people of color. We forget that there are so many allies out there, but they're invisible to us. We have to get to know them. And then enlisting one person at a time. And you know, like if there's some great like racial conflict or cultural conflict or something the company's struggling with, rush there, because that's when the tension's gonna be high. We had a situation like that at Ramsey County where we were trying to roll out a self-assessment tool, and those of us who are people of color actually ended up, I think I actually like left crying and sobbing. It was probably the worst experience of my professional career. But because I had been there for a couple of years, and people knew that I was an otherwise pretty emotionally stable person, it really said something. And you know, it was the hand that the white people on my team had to extend to me to actually help me and them along. But it came with believing that if it was really that horrible for me in that meeting, it must be really bad. And so, you know, we've used things like that at Wilder too. So look for openings where there's cultural conflict, racial conflict, and don't assume that all white people are the same. Take them out to lunch, learn about them, and you know, you do have to kind of bring people over. And it is a gradual process. I mean, I think Monty would say the same, that the relationship that we developed as a trusting bond across race was probably one of the most transformative experiences that he experienced as a white person who had never had the opportunity to actually know a person of color with that level of intimacy in terms of supervision. You know, so it happens one relationship at a time, and you only need one. You know, in community organizing, it's like if you're just you, then that's kind of not enough. But if you can have one other person, you can be a coalition or partnership. And that's kind of how I think about it. No, I mean, it's like, hey, you know, there are two of us. Great. More energy. Yep. Mm-hmm. Other questions?
Oh, yes. A lot of women asking questions.
Hi, I have a question. My question would be, do you think that being an American itself is a culture itself? So there's two or three different issues whether you are of one race or another, but once you have entered and become an American after 5 years, we have to deal with that issue. So what do you think about that?
You know, okay, this is going to sound a little radical, but I'm just going to say it. American to me, you know, in so many coded ways, has been used in through a lens of whiteness. So I just can't be an American. I'm like Hmong American. I'm an Asian American. So I think the word American sometimes gets racialized in ways that we don't even realize, because you know, all the Native peoples who are here, are they American? Do you know what I mean? The other story, and the reason why I say we are a nation of displaced people, and not saying, you know, American dream, all these other things, is, you know what, my dream was very different than someone else's dream. And frankly, we did a lot of killing people's dreams. So, you know, so my experience of America as an American is a very different experience than Naida's experience as an African American person. And so I feel like there is a sort of like a democratization process, but everybody gets socialized into a slightly different America. And so I think that American is used to, in my view, to connote white Protestant. You know, I mean, it's not, the story isn't even as inclusive as it could be. When am I an American? Being America to an American to me does have certain ideals. It's my U.S. citizenship. It's when I became a citizen at age 12, and I remember being really young when this happened because I'm naturalized. I had a very negative experience with the INS officer. He basically asked my mother if I was really her child. And my mother said in very broken Hmong, "She come out of me." Yep. Yeah. But you know, the other thing I thought of when that happened was you know, the legacy of everything historically that has happened in this country as a citizen is mine to own. And that because we are a nation of displaced people, that perhaps there might be a space for someone like me to create a better world so that other people in this community can actually not have the, are you sure you're this mother of this kid? I mean, that's ridiculous, so yeah, mm-hmm. I felt the most American when I was actually studying overseas in Germany. I was an exchange student to Berlin. And then I told people I was an American, and most of them thought I was Turkish because there's a big Turkish population. And then they also thought I was a Native American because my hair was really long and I had like dark skin then because I played a lot of tennis. So, you know, I mean, it means different things to different people. That's what it means to me. Yep. Any other questions?
We have time for one last question. All right.
Okay. Was there one last question? Yep. Oh, okay, over here. Okay. Okay, one last question. Okay. Reverse racism as in also including white people or advancing equity and kind of including everybody or what? Yep. Yeah. Okay. Oh, okay. Well, you know, I guess the first thing I would say is I've kind of gotten over that part. It is self-serving and I don't see a lot of white people going out and apologizing for advancing racial equity because they're white, you know, and I think we need to quit doing that as people of color myself, because, you know, the reality is when you do that, you deny that people actually see your skin color, and it's a way of reinforcing invisibility for people of color. So I've kind of gotten over that. Now, if you were gonna ask me what are the challenges and how have I advanced leadership in the community as an Asian American leader who, you know, has to have different strategies to keep myself authoritative, credible, you know, all these other things. I'd say that leading as a person of color on these issues and leading as a white person are very different, and that I need to have multiple messengers, or we need to have multiple messengers for the message that we're having. Change the messenger. Don't have it be you. I mean, this is when allies are really important. Frankly, you know, because of the kind of work that I do at the Wilder Foundation, I have to have allies who are black. I have to have allies who are white. I have to have allies who are, you know, Karen. I don't enter a space to talk about controversial things. You know, a white person can perhaps go as a CEO and talk about this and, you know, maybe nothing will happen. I, as an Asian American person, if I'm gonna be advancing racial equity, I need to bring other allies with me. I need to have enough support to actually do that because sometimes I'm not believed. I'm not believed. Even as the CEO of the Wilder Foundation, I can be dismissed because I am a person of color. That happens on a more regular basis than the other thing. So I'm not afraid to say, you know what, as an Asian American, here's kind of what I experience. You know, and I actually had a call to action for the CEOs in town that I'm working with or organizations a couple years ago, and it was us reporting out at Wilder about what progress we were making. And what I said to the CEOs and what I'll say to all of you is, good leaders who advance racial equity will not last forever without your support. Commissioner Ellinger will not last forever without your support. Antonia Wilcoxon, myself, Sue Haig, you know, these are challenging jobs. We need all of you to rush up and support us and to say, I know you're not quite getting it right, but I think you're halfway right or you're right here and let's move on. No, because, you know, you don't, I think that that's the part of the equation that we always miss, right? I mean, how often does a Sue Hammersmith come along? Not very often. So celebrate, recognize, and link hands. You know, you got to link hands behind the people that champion the values that you care about. And I say to people at Wilder all the time, you know what? Social justice and equity they're really important concepts. Our actions are more important. How we practice, how we show up, who we're attending to, where we are, you know, it's very important. Okay, I think we're over time. Thank you so much.
Thank you, MayKao.